Hello scholars, welcome to Dakshinai classroom. I hope you all are well and doing your studies from the safety of your home. Now in the last lecture of electromagnetic induction, that was the first lecture, we had talked about what actually is electromagnetic induction and what is Lenz law. Now if you remember, Lenz law helps us to find which direction the induced current will flow in case of electromagnetic induction. Remember, Lenz law can only tell us the direction, not the magnitude of the current. So today we are going to talk about Faraday's law. So Faraday's law tells us that how much current will flow in case of electromagnetic induction. Now remember, in case of Lenz law, only the direction of the current can be known. But in case of Faraday's law, direction, Lenz law you can find, magnitude you can find using Faraday's law. So in today's lecture, we are going to talk about Faraday's law and we will solve few problems based on Faraday's law. Now let us talk about how Faraday's law helps us to find the magnitude of current through a loop. Now if you remember, in the last lecture we have discussed that if there is a case like this, there is a loop and the magnet is moved towards the loop, then flux through the loop changes. Now what would be the flux through our loop? Flux through our loop may be written as integration of B dot ds. Why we are writing B dot ds? Because the magnitude of magnetic field at different points may be different. That is why we are writing integration of B dot ds. That you have already studied like this in case of electrostatics, Gauss law. In case of Gauss law, flux, electrostatic flux may be written as E dot ds. Same way, here magnetic flux may be written as B dot ds. That's it, nothing else. So flux is B dot ds. Now, what is the unit of flux? Unit of flux is written as Weber, which is equal to 1 Tesla meter square. B Tesla, magnetic field Tesla, surface area meter square. So 1 Tesla meter square, that is the magnitude or unit of your flux. Now, so in case flux passing through this loop is B dot ds, so according to Faraday's law, EMF produced in the field. Now EMF will only be produced when the flux passing through this loop changes. As long as flux remains constant, EMF is not produced. So according to Faraday's law, EMF is produced in the loop, if flux passing through loop changes. So if flux passing through loop changes, then across these two points there will be an EMF produced. So Faraday's law tells us how much will be this induced EMF. So here let us write, according to Faraday's law, EMF induced, or let us say induced EMF across what? Across these two points here. So induced EMF may be written as, now this is flux and EMF is induced because of change in flux. So induced EMF may be written as minus of rate of change of flux. That is your induced EMF, and this is your mathematical statement of Faraday's law. So here you can write this mathematical
मैथमेटिकल स्टेटमेंट, स्टेटमेंट ऑफ फैराडेज लॉ.
So according to Faraday's law, EMF produced across these two points here will be minus of d phi by dt, where phi is the flux of magnetic field through the area of this closed loop. Now, how this helps us find the magnitude of current? Now see here, this here is a loop, and across these two points where our galvanometer is connected, flux produced is this much. Now, if I know the resistance of this loop wire, then what I can say? Let us say that resistance of the loop is known and it is capital R. So, if resistance of loop is capital R, if the resistance of loop is capital R and potential difference across the ends of this loop is EMF is equal to minus of d phi by dt, then current through this loop, what can be written as current through this loop? Current through this loop, for example, current is flowing like this. You can use Lenz law in order to find the current direction. So, current. So, here let us write. So, current I will be equal to EMF divided by resistance. So here you can write I equals to minus of 1 by resistance d phi by dt, which is rate of change of flux, that is your EMF. So current can be found using Faraday's law in this way. So if you know the resistance of your loop, then by using Faraday's law, you can find the EMF, and EMF divided by resistance, that will give you magnitude of the current through this loop. And direction you can find using Lenz law. So Faraday's law is very easy. Only this much is Faraday's law, that EMF is nothing but minus of d phi by dt. Now why minus sign? Why there is a minus sign? Minus sign shows that EMF will be produced according to Lenz law. Minus sign is in accordance with Lenz law. That is, whenever EMF is increasing, whenever d phi by dt is positive, EMF will be negative. EMF will be trying to oppose that change. So if flux is increasing, this current will produce magnetic field in such a way that it opposes increasing flux. If flux is decreasing, this induced EMF, this current will produce magnetic field in such a way that it supports the decreasing flux. So both way, minus sign here is in accordance with Lenz law. Pause the video, note down, then we will solve problems based on Faraday's law. Now let us start with a very easy question based on Faraday's law. Now what is the question here? A conducting circular loop is placed in a uniform field of 0.02 Tesla with its plane perpendicular to field. So here it is a conducting circular loop. This white board is the plane of the loop, and here it is a uniform field coming out of the board, perpendicular to the board, and field is uniform throughout this region. I have shown only here, but assume that field is uniform throughout this region. Now, if radius of the loop starts shrinking at 1 millimeter per second, so right now radius is 2 centimeters. So if the radius of the loop starts shrinking at 1 millimeter per second, then find EMF when radius is 2 centimeters. Meaning somewhere if I attach a voltmeter, then how much that voltmeter will read. Now, so how will you do it? EMF is calculated how? EMF is calculated minus of d phi by dt. And since we are interested with only magnitude here, we can remove this minus sign. Why we are removing? Because just magnitude is needed. Now, so flux. What is flux? This magnetic field, which is constant. And area. What is area vector? Let us assume that area vector is this. So area vector and field vector, they are at 0 degree with each other. So B dot area vector can be written as BA cos 0 and cos 0 is 1. So here I can write this as differentiating B times area divided by dt. Now B is a constant, so take B outside. So this may be written as B times D of area by dt, like this. Now what is area of this circular loop? Area of this circular loop is pi r square, and pi is a constant, so take pi outside. So this I can write pi times B D of radius square divided by dt. And if I differentiate it by using chain rule, then what I can write? I can write pi times B times twice of R times dr by dt using chain rule. Now, here B is given 0.02 Tesla. Radius, at what point I need to know the EMF? I want to know the EMF when radius is 2 cm. So R is given. Dr by dt, rate of change of radius, that is also given 1 millimeter per second. So everything is known. Now I can put the value. So let us write the values. Now pi is 3.14 multiplied by B is 0.02 Tesla multiplied by 2 multiplied by radius. Radius is how much? 2 centimeter. So 0.02 meter. And rate of change of radius is 1 millimeter, which will be 10 to the power minus 3 meter per second. So into 10 to the power minus 3, like this. So when you solve this, so 2 2 4 4 8 24 56 around 2.5 into 2 4 7, yes, into 10 to the power minus 6 volts. So EMF produced in this loop will be around 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 6 approximately. Now, so if I put a voltmeter here, so if I add a voltmeter here, let us add like this. If I add a voltmeter, then EMF shown in the voltmeter will be around 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 6 volts. Given that you have voltmeter which can measure 10 to the power minus 6 volt, then you can measure. Otherwise, the voltmeter present in your laboratories will not be able to measure this small voltage. Pause the video, note down, then we will solve another question. Now let us try to solve another question based on Faraday's law. Now here the question is, a square loop of side A having n turns is rotated with a uniform angular velocity omega about one of its diagonal. So here it is a square loop. Side of this square loop is A. It is rotated with a uniform velocity omega about one of its diagonals. And here there is only one loop you are seeing, but there are n turns in that loop. There are number of turns across this loop, across this line. Now, next, they are saying that a uniform field exists in the region as shown. So here, there is a uniform field like this. No, inside. Field is inside. Uniform field is going inside the loop. Find EMF induced in the coil. Meaning, if I attach a voltmeter right now here, then what would be the EMF read by the voltmeter? Now, how do you do it? Now, see. Whenever they ask you to find the EMF, what you can simply do is, EMF is nothing but d phi by dt, just the magnitude. Now, what is EMF? Now see here, EMF induced may be written as d phi by dt. For writing d phi by dt, you know, you want to know the flux. What is the flux? Flux is nothing but field dot product with area vector. Now let us assume by convention that dot area vector is towards you, perpendicular to the loop and towards you like this. Now if the area vector is this and flux field is inside, then initial angle is 180. That is making it a little bit difficult. So let us assume that area vector is inside. There will be no difference in the answer. So let us assume that area vector is inside. So what is the angle between area vector and the field vector initially? So area vector is perpendicular to the plane of the loop, which is inside. Field is inside. So at t equal to 0, area vector and field angle is 0. So what you can say? At t equals 0, angle between area vector and field vector is 0. Now if at t equal to 0, angle between each is 0 and the loop is rotating with omega. Now see here, this is your area vector. If I rotate the loop, area vector will also rotate with the loop. That we have discussed when we were discussing torque experienced by the loop, if you remember. So if I rotate my loop, area vector will also rotate with the loop. Meaning, if the angle rotated by the loop is omega times t, then angle rotated by area vector will also be omega times t. And the field vector is not changing its direction. Meaning, if the loop rotates by omega t angle, then area vector rotates by omega t angle. And if at t equal to 0, angle between area vector and B is 0, then at t, angle between area vector and field vector is theta equals omega times t. Whatever is the angle rotated by the loop, same is the angle rotated by area vector. And if at t equal to 0, angle between them was 0, now angle between them is omega times t, like that. Now, so what is your EMF? EMF is nothing but differentiating your flux with respect to time. And what is flux? B dot area. Now, let's see that. Magnitude of the area remains constant. Magnitude of the field remains constant. What changes? Angle between them changes. So, D of B area and dot product. So, cos of theta like this. Remember, we are just taking the magnitude here. So, no need to put minus sign. So, like that. Now, here B and A are constant, they will be outside. So B, and what is the area of this loop? Area of the loop is A. A times A, side is A, so area will be A square. So B times A square. And cos theta differentiating with respect to time. You cannot differentiate cos theta with respect to time. You will have to apply chain rule. So what is the chain rule? First we will differentiate with respect to theta. So what that will be? That will be minus of sine theta times d theta by dt, like this. That is your chain rule. So that will come out to be minus of b a square sine theta. And what is d theta by dt? D theta by dt is omega, already given. So that is omega. So that is your EMF produced in one loop. Remember, that is EMF produced because of one turn. And how many turns are there? Having n turns. So for n turns, EMF produced will be equal to how much? N times EMF of one term. That will be equal to minus of N times
माइनस ऑफ n टाइम्स b a स्क्वायर ओमेगा साइन थीटा. एंड व्हाट इज थीटा? थीटा इज नथिंग बट ओमेगा टाइम्स t. सो दैट इज योर ईएमएफ प्रोड्यूस इन दिस लूप विच हैज योर n नंबर ऑफ टर्न्स रोटेटिंग विथ ओमेगा अक्रॉस अ डायगोनल एंड एरिया एरिया ऑफ वन लूप इज a स्क्वायर. दिस वे यू कैन फाइंड. And if you see here, since sine theta varies from positive to negative, this sine omega t will vary from minus 1 to plus 1. So if I talk about direction of the EMF induced, so direction of the EMF induced will also change. Why? Because this value of sine theta, it is a function of sine theta, right? And since sine theta varies from positive to negative, the direction of this EMF will also change sinusoidally. Pause the video, note it down. Now let us solve another question based on Faraday's law. Now what is the question here? Very easy question. A conducting loop of area 5 cm square is placed in a field which varies with time as B0 sin omega t. Here field itself is variable. Where V0 is 0.2 Tesla and omega is 300 per second. Normal to the coil makes an angle of 60 degree with the field. Now what is normal to the coil? For example, if this is your coil, then normal to the coil can be taken like this. And what is the area vector? Area vector is normal to the plane of the coil. This is the plane of the coil. So if the normal to the coil makes an angle of 60 degree with the field, then area vector also makes an angle of 60 degree with the field. So like that. Now, normal to the coil makes an angle of 60 degree with the field. Find the maximum field, not field, find the maximum EMF induced in the coil. Now, what would be the value of maximum EMF? Now, how would you do it? First thing you should do is find the flux. What is flux? Flux is B dot A. Now what is this? This is nothing but mod of B mod of A cos theta. What is theta? Theta is the angle between area vector and field vector. That is given as 60 degree. So let us write this. This will be B is given as B naught sin omega t. So B naught sin omega t. What is area? Area is given as 5 cm square. So 5 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter square. We have to write in SI units. Multiplied by cos theta. Cos theta is 1 by 2. Like this. So this is written as 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 4 B naught sin omega t. Like this. What is EMF? EMF is nothing but d phi by dt. Here we are taking just the magnitude. So no need for minus sign. So d phi by dt. Differentiate this. So these are positive constants. So they will come outside the differentiation. So 2.5 b naught into 10 to the power minus 4. Differentiating sin omega t with respect to t. Like this. Now what is differentiation of sin omega t? Omega cos omega t. So this can be written as 2.5 b naught omega into 10 to the power minus 4 cos of omega t. This is your EMF. Now what they are asking? They are asking maximum EMF. When this EMF will be maximum? These omega b naught are constant. But this is cos omega t. Cos omega t is varying with time. So whenever cos omega t is maximum, this EMF will be maximum. And what is the maximum value of cos omega t? Maximum value of any cos can be 1. So this can take maximum value 1. So E max, maximum EMF may be written as 2.5 times B naught. What is B naught? 0.2. What is omega? 300 into 10 to the power minus 4.
and cos omega t value is 1. Solve this, you will get how much? 300 into 0.2, that will be your 60. And 60 into 2.5, that will be your 150. So 150 into 10 to the power minus 4, that will be your 15 into 10 to the power minus 3 volt, or 15 millivolts. That is the maximum value of EMF produced across the coil. Now, if I ask you that, tell me at what time this value will be maximum. At what time? So at what time? When cos omega t is 1. That will be your homework. Find that at what time, for what time periods, for what times this cos omega t may be 1 or this EMF may be maximum. That is your homework. Pause the video, note it down. Now let us solve another question based on Faraday's law. Since we are covering only Faraday's law, we are going to solve more and more questions based on Faraday's law only. So let us solve another question based on Faraday's law. A square loop is made up of cylindrical wire of diameter 2 mm. Here is my square loop. The wire which is making this square loop is in the form of cylinder, very small cylinder. Cylinder, diameter 2 mm, very thin wire. Now, the side of the loop is given as 10 cm. Resistivity of the material of the wire is 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 8 omega meter. Ohm meter, not omega meter. So, the wire is made up of some material and resistivity of that material is given. If field in the region changes at the rate of 0.02 tesla per second. Now, here is some field in this entire region. And the field is not constant. It changes. With what rate? 0.02 tesla per second. Then find the induced current in the loop. Now if I want to find the induced current according to Faraday's law, if you remember, magnitude of the current may be written as 1 by R d phi by dt, where d phi by dt is EMF produced. So, if I want to know the current, I need two things. One is the resistance of the wire. Second is the EMF produced across the wire. So, let us find these two things. Now, what would be resistance? Resistance can be written as rho times length of the wire divided by area of the wire. Where rho is resistivity, length is total length of the wire. A, now remember, this A is not area of the loop. No. This A is the area of that diameter, area of that cylinder of which your wire is made up of. So A is not area of this loop. A is the cross section area of your wire. Now, so this is your R. Now we will write the values in the end. Now d phi by dt, what is your flux? Flux is your, see here, this is your field, this is your area vector. Theta is 0, so flux may be written as B times area, not this area. Let us write this as area dash, area of the loop. So, that will be how much? How much is field, that we do not know. So, let us write it just B. Times area, what is the area of the loop here? 10 cm multiplied by 10 cm, which is 100 cm square. In meter square, it will be how much? 10 to the power minus 2. So, B into 10 to the power minus 2. This is your flux, Weber. Now, what is d phi by dt? D phi by dt will be 10 to the power minus 2 times d of B by dt. Because B is changing at the rate of 0.02 tesla per second. So, that may be written as 2 into 10 to the power minus 4. So EMF produced is 2 into 10 to the power minus 4 volts. That is your EMF. Now, if the EMF is this much, then current is nothing but EMF divided by resistance. So let us write. What is EMF? 2 into 10 to the power minus 4. What is resistance? This much.
So write that rho times length times area of the cross section of your wire. So 2 into 10 to the power minus 4 times area of the cross section. What is the area of cross section? Since it is a cylindrical wire, area of the cross section will be pi r square. So pi times radius square. What is radius? Diameter is 2 millimeter. Radius will be 1 millimeter. In meter, 1 millimeter is 10 to the power minus 3. And when you square it, it will be 10 to the power minus 6. So 10 to the power minus 3 square divided by what is resistivity? Here resistivity is 1.7. 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 8. Multiplied by length. What is the total length of your wire? Total length of the wire is 40 centimeter. So 40 centimeter is 0.4 meter. So that is your complete picture. Now, based on this, if I want to know what is your I current, what is your current? So here it will be 2 into pi. 2 into pi is your 6.28, 6.3. And here it will be 6.8, 0.68. So approximately, you can write that, approximately it will be 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 2 ampere. See here, pi times 2, 6.3, 1.7 times 0.4, that is 0.68. Yes, 0.68. So 6.3 divided by 0.68 will be approximately 90. And 10 to the power minus 4, 10 to the power minus 6, 10 to the power minus 10. Yes, and 10 to the power minus 2 is here. So like that, your area will, your current, not area, current. Current will come out to be 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 2 ampere approximately. Pause the video, note it down. Then we will solve another question based on Faraday's law. So let us solve one last question before we wrap up this lecture on Faraday's law. Now here, find the arrangement. For the arrangement shown, find EMF induced in the loop and plot a graph of EMF versus time. Now what is this arrangement here? Let me explain. Here, there is a dotted line. And there is a uniform magnetic field on the right side of your dotted line. On the right side, there is a uniform field. But on the left side, field is zero. On the left side, field is zero. On the right side, there is a uniform field of constant magnitude B. On the right, there is a field. On the left, it is zero. Here, this is your dotted line. Now here it is a semicircular loop. Semicircular loop like this. Now this semicircular loop is rotating with a constant angular velocity omega across this axis. This is the axis, constant angular velocity omega. This semicircular loop is rotating. Now, we need to find out the EMF induced in the loop. Now initially, angle of the loop inside the area where there is magnetic field is zero. Correct? Now, if let us say theta. What is theta? Theta is the angle inside the loop at t. At time t. Now, so if this loop is rotating, after some time, what would be the situation? After some time, the loop will be like this. After some time, it has rotated and now the loop is like this. So this is the angle theta of the loop which is inside. How much will be this theta? Since the angle of the loop is constant, so this theta may be written as omega angular velocity multiplied by time taken, omega times t, like this. This is your theta. Now,
What is this area? What is this entire area? What is this area? So let us write area inside the field. How much is the area inside the field? Now see here. Area inside the field will be based on theta. Higher the theta, more will be the area. So if the total area, what is the total area? Pi r square. So area per unit angle will be how much? Area per unit angle will be pi r square divided by twice of pi. That is the area per unit angle. And what is the angle inside the your field? Angle inside the field is omega times t. So omega times t. So this is your area inside the field, which is how much? Pi pi cancel. That would be omega r square t divided by 2. This is the area inside the loop. Meaning area inside the loop is varying with time t like this. So what is the flux? What is the flux? Flux is nothing but field multiplied by area. So field is B and area inside the loop is this. Remember, when we are talking about the flux, so only through this area field is crossing. So while calculating the flux, I will consider only this shaded region. I will not consider the area which is outside the field region. So only this area will be concluded. So B times omega r square t divided by 2. That is your flux. If this is your flux, what would be your EMF produced? EMF produced may be written as minus of d phi by dt. Or if you are writing just the magnitude, then d phi by dt. That would be how much? That would be, differentiate this. So B omega r square by 2, that is the constant. And T, dt by dt is 1. So this is your EMF. So EMF produced in the coil will be B omega r square by 2 in the loop. Now, meaning if across any point you attach a voltmeter like this. If I attach a voltmeter here, then what would be the reading of the voltmeter? B omega r square divided by 2. Now, so this B omega r square by 2, whether it is changing with time, whether it is time dependent? No, it is time independent. Meaning this EMF is constant. So this EMF will remain constant? Not exactly. There will be a slight variation in this EMF. How? See here. Let us try to draw the graph. Let us try to draw a plot of EMF versus time. Let us say that this is time. This is your EMF. So, while the loop is going inside, let us take EMF to be positive. So, while the loop goes inside, EMF will remain positive until, up to what time? Up to the time when this loop becomes like this. Up to that time, EMF will remain this. So, what is that time? How much angle you have rotated? You have rotated pi angle. So what would be the time? Time will be, pi. Pi divided by omega. That is the time. So up to that time, from 0 to 2, 0 to that time, EMF is this. So up to certain time, EMF is positive. What about after that time? See here. After that time, loop will be, let us say, something like this. Now what is happening? Now this is the area inside the field region. So previously flux was increasing. When the loop was going inside, flux was increasing. Now the loop is coming outside the field region. Now the flux is decreasing. So what should happen to the direction of EMF? Initially, when the flux was increasing and now the flux is decreasing, in both the cases, direction of the EMF should be opposite. Why? Because EMF is actually what? Minus of df by dt, d phi by dt, right? So if d phi by dt is positive in the first case, when the loop was going inside and now the loop is coming outside, so d phi by dt will be negative. So in both the cases, d phi by dt is changing direction. Previously it was positive, now it is negative. So your direction of EMF will also change. So if initial case, when the flux is going increasing, if the initially I have taken positive EMF, so if when the flux is decreasing, then I will have to take negative EMF. So after this time, flux will be negative. Up to what time? Up to the entire loop comes out. And after that, again flux will be positive. After that, again flux will be negative. And this cycle would repeat. So EMF versus time curve will be like this. Here, the time will be how much? Pi by omega. Here, it will be 2 pi by omega. Here, it will be 3 pi by omega. And so on. Now remember, I have arbitrarily taken that when the EMF is increasing, when the flux is increasing, EMF is positive. So in that way, you can use Faraday's law in order to find the EMF. Now, if they ask you what is the current, then once you find the EMF, finding the current magnitude is very easy. Just divide EMF divided by resistance. So if I just divide EMF by the resistance of the loop, then simply that is your current. So once you find the EMF, finding the current is very easy. Pause the video, note it down. So this was your Faraday's law. We have tried to solve almost all types of question based on Faraday's law. Now remember, Faraday's law while tells you that how much EMF will be induced and how much current will be induced, it does not actually tells you why that EMF is induced. We have seen Faraday's law, which is EMF is minus of d phi by dt. But why that EMF is induced, that is not discussed under the Faraday's law. So in the next lecture, we will try to discuss what is the reason behind the induced EMF. Until then, revise Faraday's law and try to solve as many questions as you can based on this topic.